Hey guys, Sarah Picaro. Today's video is going to be about 12 signs of narcissistic abuse that you've experienced narcissistic abuse. So 12 signs you've experienced narcissistic abuse, plus how to get help. So really quickly, I'm going to list the signs so that you can just checkpoint them, and then we're going to dive into each of those signs a little bit deeper, and then share with you some information on how to get help afterwards. So 12 signs you've experienced narcissistic abuse. Sign number one, false perfection. You may be asking yourself, what is false perfection? Second sign, doubt from others. This is a big one, and this is one that keeps people stuck in that space of gaslighting and questioning their sanity and staying in the past of what ifs for far too long. So the doubt from others is the second sign that you've experienced narcissistic abuse. Again, we're going to get into all of these a little bit deeper in just a moment. The next sign is a smear campaign, and then there's isolation. There's self-blame, indecisiveness, freezing. Freezing is one of the trauma responses. So the fight, flight, freeze, and fawn. And I've done videos on those that are separate. You can dive through my channel to find out more information about those. But freezing, a lot of times we just absolutely freeze and panic. We become paralyzed. That's a sign of narcissistic abuse. Then there's physical symptoms that we're going to get into. Restlessness, loss of self. You literally look in the mirror and don't see or recognize the person staring back at you as you. There are boundary issues, obviously, that come into play when you've experienced narcissistic abuse, not only in that relationship, but in all relationships, that those boundary issues show up. It can impact you. Then there's anxiety, depression, symptoms of anxiety, depression, and what to do after you have experienced narcissistic abuse. So that's what this video is going to be about today. Let's get into this, an overall understanding of what narcissistic abuse is. Narcissistic personality disorder, or NPD, is a complex mental health condition that typically involves persons with low emotional empathy. They have a sense of cognitive empathy. They do study their victims and mimic them. It's called the mirroring. It's what they do. They study their victims, they mirror them, and then they project that so that you think, wow, I've really found my soulmate. This person gets me and they understand me. That's cognitive empathy. That's very, very different from emotional empathy. That will be completely void in the narcissistic relationship. There are all kinds of narcissists, and there's a range and a paradigm. We're not going to get into that in this video today, as it is about the 12 signs that you've experienced narcissistic abuse, but there's a need for admiration and attention and a grandiose or inflated sense of self. And I think most people watching this video would say, well, isn't that everyone? Isn't that, you know, 2021? Isn't that millennials? Isn't that society? We're not going to go down that road today, but I mean, it is much deeper than that. There's patterns of manipulation, controlling behavior that involves both verbal abuse, emotional manipulation. So those are probably the most prevalent and relevant things that you will notice that you've experienced. Lack of emotional empathy, a void of any emotional recognition, validation. They don't seem to even be bothered by the fact that you're bothered or upset or hurt. And this all can fall under the umbrella of narcissistic abuse. So these tactics are used to manipulate, control, demean you, belittle you, gaslight you, get you to question your reality, what's truth, what isn't, and they sprinkle in half truth. So you think, well, they're kind of right. Yeah, I can kind of see that. And overall, impact and significantly damage your self-esteem, your ability to connect with yourself. So keep in mind that abuse and narcissism aren't always related. We're not talking about physical abuse in this video, specifically just the 12 signs of narcissistic abuse. And the false perception, that this is when the narcissist at first, when you first met them, seemed so perfect. They seemed like your soulmate. It seemed like love at first sight. This is generally how most narcissistic abusive relationships begin. They begin with a love bombing phase, and narcissistic abuse does generally follow a clear pattern. And this pattern might look a little bit different depending on the type of relationship or the realms of the relationship. It was a romantic relationship or started off as a friendship or a partnership at work, whatever it is. But when it starts to enter into that space of turning into a relationship, it almost always begins with the love bombing phase to really flood your body with dopamine, with happy, feel-good hormones and chemicals, to bomb you with love, essentially. And that suggests that they do that because they want to get you so high and so in love that later on in the phases of narcissistic abuse, when they begin to withdraw that and take that away from you, you go back to wanting that person that they were in that phase. So it's no wonder you fell for them, because generally in this stage, and like I said, it's different for everyone. Some people bring it on hardcore, and some it's a little more slow. So either way, they get you addicted and hooked to this love that they're giving you, and they shower you with admiration, with words. I mean, love languages come into play here. Maybe they give you gifts, words of affirmation, maybe quality of time. Maybe you're spending a ton of time together in the beginning of this relationship. Again, they mirror you and they learn about you, and then they give you what you want so that you just think that you are so incredibly in love and this person is perfect and you bet your match and they're your soulmate and all these things. And in the early stage, in the love bombing phase, when you think this person is so perfect, the love that you had, I do love, because love is not abuse, and that's what it feels like, is love. But actually what's happening is that you're being emotionally abused, manipulated, and controlled. But in that early stage, that love felt so intense and so incredibly overwhelming, you never ever stopped to consider that this might be too good to be true, that this might be too incredible, too fantastic. And slowly, other manipulative tactics begin to become weaved into this relationship. Again, they begin to pull away and lower the scale of the love that you get to experience with them in the beginning of the relationship. Narcissistic parents do this with their children as well. They offer love, they offer praise, they offer adoration, they offer even financial support. Until you do something to displease them, then they will pull that away. I even noticed this in my daughter. She says, I don't know if I can say it on here. She does not say the nicest things about her dad, but she does say that she loves her dad. And they said, well, tell me what you love about daddy. And she said that he buys me gifts. So narcissistic parents will do this with their children. Children are no different to them than if you're in an adult, partnership. So it's any kind of relationship that you're in with a narcissist, they will learn that about you. Children are easy to please, right? Because you get them what they want. You buy them toys, you take them places. And then when they are displeased, they will stop doing those kind of things. So that is where this person seems so great. And even in the eyes of a child to a parent, this parent can seem so great. I'm going to plug in my computer really quick. Second one, and this one not so much in the case of children, but more in adult relationships and partnerships. When you go on to tell people doubt the abuse took place. Oftentimes, the narcissist will have this perception that they are this incredible, wonderful person. And because narcissistic abuse can be so subtle, especially when it happens in public, I have another video about covert narcissists and how one of the ways that they will subtly devalue you is when you're out in public and they walk in front of you. It's as if they can't even be seen with you. So that is disguised abuse. And when abuse is disguised so subtly, other people often fail to recognize or fail to see what you see or fail to see what you're saying is happening. They say things like, I just don't see that. I know them and the person that I know is this, 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 and this. And so it leads the victim to really not fully understanding what's happening. You only know that you feel confused. You know that you feel upset. You often feel guilty for the mistakes that you think that you made, because when you're sharing your experience with other people, they're sharing a different experience with you. And so you begin confused in all of that and are thinking, why do I feel this way that I feel then? If no one else is seeing it, it must be me. And the narcissist wants their victims to be in that state of, it must be me. It must be my fault. It must be something I'm doing wrong. Even when it comes to the realms of a narcissistic parent, they may make jokes at the children's expense, and the narcissistic partner may make jokes and say, God, I'm just kidding. I'm just joking. Yeah, I just can't help myself. It's just that you, and then they'll always turn it around and put it on you. And you're telling your friends or you're telling people about this, and they're saying, come on, they were just joking. They didn't really mean that. I know that person. They didn't really mean that. And you're hoping that your loved ones, your family, that your friends would believe you. But unfortunately, this doesn't always happen, because they're getting a different experience and having a different perception with this same narcissist. So you're sharing your perception of reality and they're sharing their perception of reality, which more in line matches what the narcissist wants theirs to be. And so you're feeling completely isolated. That's going to lead into another sign of narcissistic abuse. But that is one of the things that other people doubt you and doubt your experience or telling you, oh, you're just being too sensitive or you're just being too emotional. And then you begin to really take on those beliefs, those other people's beliefs that that's true about you. You are being too sensitive, overly emotional. And that's doubt. And that self-doubt can be harming. And it impacts your ability to listen to your gut feeling and to your intuition because you're believing them and you're discounting your experience with them. So that doubt can be dramatically harming. Not only does it dismantle your faith in your loved ones, your friends, your support system, and your support structure, it can lead to you wondering, doubting that the abuse ever even took place after all. And maybe you agree with them and you say, okay, maybe you're right. Maybe I did read too much into it. Or, you know, I just imagined that that happened because the narcissist and other people may say things to you like that never happened. Come on, get over it. And you're thinking maybe it didn't ever happen. And maybe it was just a subtle look of disgust on their face and they're saying, I never did that. And then again, you're doubting your question and your perception of reality. Then they will start a smear campaign. They will make it that they're the ones that have been victimized and attacked. And the smear campaign is where they set out to completely ruin your reputation and your name. People with narcissistic traits often have to maintain their image of perfection in order to keep admiration from others, in order to keep their posse, their flying monkeys on their side. And to do this, they do so by making you or making the victim look bad, as if you're the crazy one, as if you're the one who's lost your marbles and has no idea what you're talking about. And once you begin pointing out their flaws and their imperfections and their problems or questioning their behavior, they will lash out and you will experience narcissistic rage. And when the narcissist is enraged, you can bet your bottom dollar that they're going to smear your name. They're going to openly direct their rage towards you with insults, with threats. I mean, I've had my ex say that he was going to, I don't know if I can even say this on here, completely end my life and my family's life. I mean, he was ex-military, so he started to threaten things that felt so real that kept me frozen in the state of fear for a number of years. They will involve others in criticizing you. Those are what are known as flying monkeys. They will get other people on their side to come at you, to connect with you, to attack you and say, you know, what you're doing to him or her is not right. And this is about the smear campaign, about getting everyone on their side and having you feel isolated and alone and scared to kind of go against this mob or this army that is supporting the narcissist. And by telling your loved ones stories, they will interject, they will triangulate, and oftentimes twist the facts of your unstable or your harmful behavior. And they will say, no, that's actually not what happened. What happened was... And in that story, in that sharing, the narcissist will try to discredit you. And even worse, when you react in anger against that, because you're triggered, you're hurt, and you're projecting your own hurt and anger back onto them, they can use your responses to back up their lies and say, see, what didn't I tell you? Look at what this person just messaged me, told you. So that is why it is so imperative to heal those wounds and those triggers, take those triggers as teachers and not project them back onto the narcissist because they can and will turn around and use them against you. So people with people who are narcissists or people with narcissism often have a knack for pulling others in, for charming others, for getting them on their side. And these people, unfortunately, are falling prey and victim to the same type of abuse that you endured. You're just at a different point in the road. You're further down the road and you're seeing it and you're trying to say, oh my God, I finally understand what's going on, and trying to get other people to see and understand what's going on, but they're not there yet. So those people are going to turn against you as well. And the narcissist loves using other people against you. That persona that they showed in the beginning, well, everyone else sees that in them, even though you're getting a different angle and experience perception with the narcissist. So they can often win the support of your loved ones who have not yet seen through that facade. They can often triangulate and pull your friends, your support away from you, because they're saying, well, look at you, look at this person, by insisting that they only have your best interest at heart. I remember going to therapy and counseling with the first covert narcissistic husband, as he sat there and rubbed my arm and said, you know, I love her. I'm here to support her. Whatever she wants and needs to work through this, I am in support of that. And then, oh my God, when we got home and those doors closed, it was a completely different story. But in front of that caring, loving therapist, oh, you better believe that it was the most incredibly supportive husband that ever walked this earth. So when you try explaining the abuse to loved ones or the people who were seemingly in support of you, those people may side with the narcissist. So that's a part of the smear campaign, that they get this whole army against you. And this leads into the next sign of narcissistic abuse is isolation. You completely feel alone in all this when those that you're trying to go to for support and trying to share your story and your experience with won't listen to you or support the narcissist or try to get you to think that it wasn't that bad or it didn't happen that way. This leaves you even more vulnerable and more susceptible to manipulation, because the person abusing you at this point may pull you back in with kindness. They start the love bombing cycle again. They pull you back in with kindness. They begin to apologize. They begin to say that they understand how much they hurt you and how sorry they are. They begin to pretend that the abuse never happened. They do the things that they did in the beginning of the relationship to get you back, right? And they're going to say that they're working on all of the things that they know that you want and need to hear, so that they can get you to come back in. And this tactic is a tactic that's known as hoovering, and that often works better when you feel isolated, alone, and when you lack support. So when you're in that space of isolation, you're more likely to doubt your perceptions of the abuse when there's no one to talk to about it, or no one who believes, backs you up and supports you and says, I completely get it, I agree, I see it too. So if the people that you have in your corner make a mistake and encourage you to go back to the abusive partner or give that person another chance, you might end up doing so in this stage when you feel completely isolated, in order to regain that connection with them. Because not only have you lost the connection with the narcissist, you've lost the connection with all those people that maybe once were your friends, or once were on your side, or once were on both of your sides. And you don't want to feel completely alone on a deserted island, and it's like all of the other people are on the island with the narcissist, and so you end up giving up and giving in and believing all of them, it may not be that bad. All the while behind your back, there are so many other things happening that no one else is seeing. The next sign of narcissistic abuse, when all this occurs, is you freeze up, right? There's the fight, flight, or freeze. And maybe you fight back verbally or physically, and we do that to protect ourselves. All of those are protective mechanisms. Flight, you run away, you want to get out, but oftentimes you end up running away and then back into the arms of the abuser. And then you may just freeze up. Maybe the abuse is happening and occurring and you think, oh my gosh, again, why did I do this? And you just freeze up, like literally and physically in your body, everything freezes because it's a trauma response. So people respond to abuse and trauma in different ways. And you might attempt to confront the abusive behavior, but freeze up when you do so. It may feel like there's a lump in your throat. You may try to leave the situation or kick that person out and then let them back, or you run off to your mother's or your family's or friend's house for a week. And when those things don't work and the love bombing phase begins, you end up coming back. And if those methods don't work, or you feel unable to use them, you can't run away and you can't fight back because you just feel like, you know what, I never win, you might respond by freezing instead. Because your body's going to go through those. Okay, which one of those is going to work for me? Well, I can't run away. I have nowhere to go. I can't fight back because I always lose. So then maybe your body says, I know, just freeze. And this is not a conscious process that occurs. The freeze response usually happens when you're in a state of feeling helpless and that there's nothing that you can do. When you feel helpless and hopeless, it will freeze. And in the freeze state, this often includes disassociation, because emotionally distancing yourself from the abuse can decrease its intensity. It's effectively numbing some of the pain and the distress that you experience. So in that space, your mind says, yes, this is an effective technique. Because when you can disassociate and disconnect emotionally, it can numb some of the physical pain and distress that you're experiencing when you're in that state of freeze. And freezing can have a benefit in certain situations. If it didn't, then your body wouldn't use it as a protective mechanism, but it doesn't help much when you can't escape from the danger. So if you believe there's no way out of the relationship, then you might remain in that frozen state instead of using that space and that time to seek support and seek help and seek safety in that moment. The next sign that you have experienced narcissistic abuse is that you have trouble making decisions. When you have experienced this pattern of devaluation and criticism, it can leave you with very, very low or very, very little confidence and self-esteem. So when you've experienced narcissistic abuse, you've got a history of making bad decisions, against going against your gut feeling, that inner knowing, that intuition, and you have this sense and this feeling that you can't do anything right, and you have frequent implications of that. Frequent thoughts, frequent feelings of, God, I can't do anything right. What's wrong with me? And when you're with a narcissist or with an abusive partner, they've even further perpetuated that by verbally abusing you, by calling you stupid, by calling you ignorant, by calling you dumb, telling you that you've got rocks for brains. They may insult you with what's known as a falsely affectionate tone. They may say things like, oh, honey, you're just so dumb. I mean, How would you make it without my help? What would you do without me? So that's what's known as a falsely affectionate tone when they're devaluing and discarding you, but they're saying in a kind way, oh, babe, I don't know what you would do without me. You're such an idiot. I don't think you would ever survive. And over time, what happens is that your unconscious mind begins absorbing these insults and attaching to them a sense of and self-perception, this perception of yourself, that is who you really are. You are someone who would not be able to make it or survive without them. You are someone who is dumb. You are someone who is incapable and are someone who needs to constantly second guess yourself as a result of that. So that's what that means. And these gaslighting tactics also make you doubt your decision-making abilities. You can make a decision, but then you quickly retract it or feel afraid to even make a decision at all because you're constantly doubting, you constantly need to check in or get other people's opinions or allow other people to make decisions for you. So that if someone manipulates you into believing that you imagine that things actually took place, you might continue doubting your perception of events. And this uncertainty does affect your ability to make decisions well into the future. That is, until you remove that programming that was installed and reinstall programming that has you know without a shadow of a doubt that you have the capability and ability to make decisions for yourself. And if they don't work out, okay, you can take it as a mistake or an opportunity to learn and make a different decision next time. But oftentimes when you're stuck in that frozen state, because of the repeated pattern and maybe years or decades of someone making you believe that these things didn't take place, that actually did, that uncertainty can become a deeply rooted and planted seed in your unconscious mind and can feel, this is where we're going to get into this later, can make you feel that it's going to take a long time to heal from this, but it doesn't. So you're in good hands. The next thing that will occur that is a sign that you've experienced narcissistic abuse is that you have this unconscious pattern of programming running in your mind, almost like this tape, the storyline of your life, that you've always done something wrong. You always feel like you've done something wrong. This is a key characteristic of narcissism. Is it difficulty taking responsibility or having any kind of accountability or negative actions for harmful behavior, which makes you as the victim feel like you've always done something wrong? Abusive partners will always find a way to cast blame on you instead of accepting that blame for themselves and going, you're right, I messed up, I shouldn't have done that, and following up with a change behavior when they give an apology. That's the best way to know that someone actually truly is sorry, is not to listen to their words, but take a look at their actions. Do their behaviors change after they verbalize that they're sorry? If not, then it's not a true, genuine apology. And you'll notice that narcissists may apologize, some do, some don't, but their actions or behaviors never change. So they might accomplish this through deceit. And oftentimes they do this by insisting that they said something that you don't remember. What I said was, and you're thinking, I know exactly what you said. And that is not what you said. I don't remember you saying that, but they will insist that they did. Or by getting so angry, so mad, so enraged, so violent, even if it's just verbal violence, that you end up soothing them. You end up being the one that apologizes and agreeing that you were wrong, even though you know you weren't. So this is a part of the abuse. So say that you think that they've cheated on you, or you suspect them, or you even have solid and valid proof that they cheated on you. And you explain the concerning behaviors. You explain, hey, I caught you. You were in the bathroom. I went through your phone and I saw that you were texting, who's Gina? And you bring this up to them and they respond with extreme anger. They completely go off on you with the, how are you doing going through my phone? I don't go through your phone. All I do, I can't even go to the bathroom without you going through my phone. How dare you doubt my loyalty? I'm with you, aren't I? If I wanted to go be with Gina, I'd go be with Gina. But here I am, stuck home with you. And you're going through my phone while I'm going to the bathroom. After I show you how much I love you, after I do this for you, after I do that for you, how would you even know? Like, what are you doing going through my phone anyway? And they react with extreme anger and say that you were snooping through their things. Obviously, if you loved me, you wouldn't be snooping through my phone. And then they go on and on and on about it. And then you end up apologizing for going through their phone, even though the very fact that you did that is how you got proof that they were cheating on you. And suddenly you're apologizing for going through their phone. And because of the anger, completely distracted from the fact that they cheated on you and making you feel like you're the crazy one. They can't even be with you. How can I be with someone who goes through my phone like that? When you're thinking, how can I be with someone who cheats on me like that? So even after leaving a relationship, if you don't do the inner work to heal after having been in a narcissistic relationship and you simply get into another one, you more than likely are going to carry forward the belief that you can't do anything right. And that's going to significantly impact all of your future relationships until you do the inner work to heal from all of that mess in your mind. So when things go wrong in other areas of your life, you might struggle to accept that you didn't cause those problems, just like you didn't cause that person to cheat on you. They chose to cheat on you. But in your head and in your mind, you're thinking, well, I guess I did cause them to do that. Maybe I didn't sleep with them as much as they wanted to. We have different, you know, different sex drives. And maybe it was my fault because I would work all the time and I'm tired and I'm exhausted and I'm just not in the mood, and making you feel like it's your fault. Even after you leave the relationship, if you don't do the inner work to deprogram and then reprogram and get back and reset your unconscious mind, chances are you're going to carry those behaviors into the next relationship. And when you don't trust yourself because of that emotional and manipulation and abuse that endured in that last narcissistic relationship, it's going to continue to show up and impact all of your relationships moving forward. The next thing, and this is really, really common, another sign that you've experienced narcissistic abuse, is that you have unexplained physical symptoms. Hands down, almost every person that I work with, if they're being completely honest with me, does share that they have also experienced physical symptoms. Sometimes it leads to disease, like really extreme disease, like cancer, fibroid, myalgia, I just had a brain fart. rheumatoid arthritis, all of these things, like inflation in their body. So many things. I've had women who've experienced breast cancer, ovarian cancer. And it may be even small, subtle changes, like physical symptoms that change, like upset stomach or nauseous all the time. Even certain smells can trigger you. One that used to trigger me in the past was the smell of the cologne that person wore when we'd go out on dates. Even, you know, 2 or 3 years after not being with that person, if I was somewhere and I smelled that cologne, I would just get triggered again. So sometimes it can be physical symptoms like that, muscle aches and pains, because you're so tense all the time that you can feel like you're just so like this, your everything is in that like trauma response. Insomnia, you may not be able to sleep at night. You may have recurring nightmares or bad dreams, fatigue. You just feel emotionally exhausted. Adrenal fatigue is a very real thing from people who've experienced narcissistic abuse. Appetite changes, emotionally overeating or undereating, gaining a lot of weight, losing a lot of weight, unhealthy weight, stomach pain, other gastrointestinal distress. I had a client who was diagnosed with IBS, and that went away just like that. Her testimony is on my YouTube channel as well, if you want to check that out. Her name is Jen. Using alcohol or other substances can sometimes seem like a helpful way to manage these symptoms, especially insomnia. But actually, the more you drink before you go to bed, the more your sleep is impacted and the more tired you feel in the morning. But some people think, well, I just need, you know, a couple glasses of wine so I can chill out, relax, and go to sleep at night. But as a result, you end up consuming more than you would like in an effort to manage these unwanted feelings or these physical symptoms that you're body is experiencing and causing distress. That leads to the next sign of narcissistic abuse, is that you feel restless and unsettled. Narcissistic abuse can be very unpredictable. It's not like, oh, today is day three. He's going to be nice today. You have no idea what you're going to get sometimes. It can be so unpredictable. The smallest, slightest little things can completely set the narcissist off and trigger them. So you may not know whether you're going to get belittled and criticized and yelled at or completely blamed for everything, or they're going to show up with flowers and surprise you with a nice gift. You just never know what you're going to get with them. And this can leave you feeling restless and unsettled. So if you don't know what someone will do or say at any given moment, you're left feeling like you're always walking on eggshells. You're always waiting for the other shoe to drop, and you develop this tension. We're talking about the physical symptoms where your body and your tension is just tied up in knots, and you can even feel it in your shoulders and in your neck, and just because what's happening is that you are preparing yourself to face conflict. And this happens all the time, this preparing of like that. I mean, is think about it physically. If someone's going to punch you, you're not just going to smile. You're going to prepare to, right? And that's what happens when you're in a relationship with a narcissist. Unconsciously, you're always preparing to face potential conflict. And then you worry about the constant stream of criticism. You worry about, how should I handle the abusive behaviors? Okay, well, last time he did this and I did that and it just made it worse. So this time, what I'm going to do is, and so you're always stuck in the thoughts of the past and the what ifs, and you begin to recognize that you're always feeling like you're on edge all the time, because you are. You're always waiting for the other shoe to drop. You may not even know how to relax anymore. Maybe you get, you know, a nice vacation, you get a week off. You can't even relax. You'd rather be at work. And even though work is crazy and overwhelming and stressful, you'd rather be there because you can't even enjoy time off or don't even know how to relax anymore. You might not even feel safe to let your guard down anymore, even when you're not around the narcissist. You might not even know how to let your guard down or be vulnerable or open up to people that used to be really close, your best friends. And that leads to the next sign of narcissistic abuse. You don't even recognize yourself anymore. When facing abuse, many, many people are forced to adjust their identity to accommodate the abuse. So you have to be someone, you become someone that you're not, to accommodate the abuse, to make it more subtle, to subdue it so that it's not as bad. And in that, you completely lose who you are. That's why many, many people that I work with say, Sarah, I just want to get back to who I used to be. I used to be strong, confident, independent. I don't even know who this person is. I know it's me, but it's not me. This isn't me. Who I've become is not me. So if you had an abusive partner who insists that when you go out with friends that you're going out and you're going out and you're sleeping with other people, you don't love me, you must not love me, you'd rather spend time with them than with me. And you're thinking, well, that's what normal people do. Normal people go out with their friends. It doesn't mean that I don't love you. It doesn't mean I'm going to be out cheating on you. We're just going out to dinner and a movie. We're just going out to dinner. Like, what do you mean? But you get to this place where you don't even recognize yourself. You're not a person who used to like beg or even care if someone else said that you couldn't go out with someone. You just go, okay, bye. And now all of a sudden you're begging and pleading and changing your plans or saying, you know what, fine, I'll just stay at home, whatever. That's what's going to make you happy. But that's not the real you. And of course you say you love this person, right? So you stop going out with your friends, you give up your hobbies, you skip, you know, going out to events with anybody, with coworkers, with people. You end up canceling your plans and just saying, you know what, fine, it's fine, I won't go. And spending time doing either A, nothing, or B, what the partner wants you to do, so that you can prove to them that you really love them, that you really care about them. And over time, those changes often lead to a complete lack or loss of your sense of who you are. And that leaves you feeling empty inside. It leaves you feeling completely void. You have a really, really difficult time after a long time of experiencing that, even knowing what your purpose is, who you are, what you like, what you don't like. You've lost sense of your purpose and place in life. And that can lead to the next sign of a narcissistic abuse is having trouble setting boundaries. In that space, you couldn't set boundaries. You couldn't say no, because then you would be punished for it. So someone engaging in narcissistic abuse has very, very, very little respect for boundaries. They always say that people who benefit the most from boundaries are those who, those who don't like boundaries are the ones that benefited from others never having any. So if they were able to get you to not have boundaries, they benefited from it. But I mean, we all respect boundaries, because then we know we feel safe. We know what's okay. We know what's not okay. And when you try to enforce boundaries on someone who has benefited from you not having any, when all of a sudden you say, you know what, I'm going to begin to enforce boundaries, they accept that as a challenge, and they will punish you for that. They will ignore you for that. The narcissist will stonewall you. They will give you the silent treatment until they get what they want from you. And eventually you might just go, whatever, and you might throw your hands up and just give up on those boundaries altogether, because implementing boundaries with a narcissist can just make it worse. That is, until you are on the other side of the equation, relationship with them. So once you end the relationship, once you distance yourself from them, then you even fall trapped to this and pray to this. I'm going to go no contact. I'm going to delete them. I'm going to block them. They know you. They know how to get to you, especially if you have not healed those inner triggers and those wounds. They know exactly where those buttons are to push. And eventually they will do the things that they know they need to do to get through to you. And they will push the buttons to wear you down. And I hope if you're in that space, you're staying strong and you're surrounding yourself by support and by people who care about you, because they don't give up easily. Narcissists do not just go, oh, okay, goodbye, supply. They thrive off supply, and you once were that core and main source of supply. Yes, they always have side supply, but if you were the main source of their supply, they're going to continue to try and get in there to try and break you down, so that you will put your boundaries off to the side. They can get back in there and continue the abuse. So if you have experienced narcissistic abuse, you more than likely need support in the areas of setting healthy boundaries, not only in the relationship with yourself, because there's a lot of guilt and shame around you letting others do what they did to you for that length of time, but also setting boundaries with other people, not only with the narcissist, but with everyone in your life. It's not an area of your life where that just impacts this one relationship. This type of abuse often shows up in all of your relationships. So in the relationship with yourself and with everyone else. So difficult time setting boundaries. That's a definite sign of narcissistic abuse. Another one is the signs and symptoms of anxiety and depression. Anxiety is worry that's spiraled out of control, and depression is living in the past. Anxiety and depression. Anxiety is about the future. Depression is about the past. And you live in one of those two instead of the present moment. So the significant stress that you face can trigger persistent worries, feelings of worry, feelings of nervousness, feelings of fear, feelings of anxiety, especially when you know what to expect from their behavior. Again, it goes back to that feeling like you're walking on eggshells all the time. You might feel hopeless. You might feel worthless. You might lose interest in the things that used to bring you joy. Maybe you used to love reading or painting or running or biking or whatever it was. And now even the thought of that, you just go, And that's a sign of depression. Like when you're just completely numb, right? Even when you're thinking about when someone says, well, you used to love painting. You used to love to run. You know, why don't you paint and run again? And you just go, And you struggle to see any hopeful outcome for the future, because the future is where the anxiety and the worry lives. So it's really, really common, if you've been in a narcissistic relationship, to have a lot of confusion over what seems to cause them to have changed so abruptly, especially if you're new to learning about narcissism. It just seems like one day a switch flipped. But that's actually not the case. The abuse was occurring slowly and subtly over time. So you might blame yourself for the abuse, which can lead to the feeling and the experience of depression, because perhaps believing their accusations, you believe all the things that they said about you, that, you know, well, you must not have loved me. If you're doing this to me, if you're just going to leave me, if you're going to break up our family, even though they're the ones that kind of force you to leave them because of the things that they did to you. You end up blaming yourself for all of the deception that took place within the relationship, and that can spiral you into this black hole of depression, and it can add to the feelings of worthlessness and further diminish your confidence and your self-esteem and your trust in yourself. So these are all the signs of narcissistic abuse. I know this has been a long video, but thank you for staying in with me. If you have endured and experienced this and are looking for an incredibly powerful way to transform the place inside is inside your mind, right? I mean, physically you can get out, but mentally it may feel like you're locked into that prison of this narcissistic abuse, even if you're out of the relationship, even if you're divorced from this person. I mean, so much goes into experiencing this stuff. All of these things. So if that is you and you're ready to go on the incredible, wonderful, powerful journey to transform and heal after having experiences, I would love to see if either my online group program is a good fit for you, or if you want to take it even further into reprogramming your unconscious mind, getting to the root of those beliefs and ripping them out, installing much more powerful, positive new ones so that you can live powerfully, incredibly happy, authentic, genuine, peaceful life. Then let's connect. You can head on over to my website. There's more information in the link in the description below this video that you can find ways for us to connect and learn more. Thanks, guys.